So I'm Weiting from Intel. It's the last session today, so I won't take so much time to you, but it is a really interesting topic to you, I think. Okay. So first of all, I would like to say, actually, we have three different topics today related with FPGA. First two is actually related about how to use FPGA to accelerate your big data workload. But in a real world, you still need a resource manager like Yum to allocate your device to your application. That's why we would like to introduce this one idea, and also it has already been implemented in Hadoop 3.1, so you can just to try. I have the link for you, and also you can try to use this kind of feature by using Yum, okay? This is legal notice. And I would like to introduce by myself, right? So actually, this is what our team are doing. So I would like to show you about, we are the team in Intel China, and we actually focusing on the big data project. Usually it is open source, so we contribute to the open source and the community to help the community become well, okay. And this is our last session related with FJ. We also got two other sessions, just like I said, both of them are related with how to use FJ to accelerate your big data. And we got another one. It's a higher level, optimization technology by using the software. So we divided it to two different parts. And this is today's agenda. So I would like to show you about the background and also how it works in Yum, and also in detail about why we would like to do that. And first of all, we have some open discussion about how to use Yum and also other resource manager to control your CPU or different resource to combine to, and manage it as a heterogeneous platform. So what we usually focusing on is actually a heterogeneous platform. There are so many different resources like CPU or GPU or FPGA. We are also working on ASCII features with CPU. So in the future, CPU. You will Intel will provide more ASIC features in with CPU, but for FPGA plan we also have another roadmap with FPGA. So in the future, actually we are facing on a heterogeneous platform, and with so many different type of resources. So it's really hard to do that. That is why we are usually focusing on this kind of, Yum, like a resource manager to, or Kubernetes. We are also focusing on Kubernetes to control this kind of scenario, to to get more features or then the customer to control more different device. Okay. So. This graph should be very familiar, since it is what we are working on with Yum. And as you can see, just like in Yum, it just by task to allocate the CPU core by task, right? So by default, it will allocate single core per task. So what we are doing is actually, this way is actually treat a CPU as a first class resource in Yum. So what we would like to do is actually to provide the same scenario with FPGA. So then the FPGA can be treated as a first class citizen in Young, and then like this kind of scenario, we can just put a task into a FPGA device, and then the task can running on a FPGA. Okay, so this is our problem definition about the entire idea is actually to provide a heterogeneous way to manage the entire system. It's not just about the FPGA. We also need to provide the sense concept for GPU. Just like in right now in Spark community, they are also focusing on the GPU integration, since machine learning is really hard, so they need to provide the GPU support in Young as well. So what we are doing is actually focusing on FPGA to running in Young, okay? And we would like to let you know FPGA actually has some advantage, since FPGA is reprogrammable. So the idea becomes more complexity that we would like to replace the FPGA IP to give the FPGA card with new features by workload request. So the entire idea is actually to provide a way to run the workload by request, and also to add the new feature from the FPGA, and then the FPGA can handle by request to handle the request from the workload. Okay. So we submit a Young patch. The Young patch, the patch number is 5983. So you can actually find the issue list in the website, and also to see the more detailed information in Young web page. Okay. So the entire idea is actually just like I said. The first part is actually Spark will submit the workload request to Young, and the Young will start to allocate the resources by request. Just like if there's no FPGA, then it will use the same way to submit a workload with the CPU, right? So what we would like to do is actually to provide a new feature, then the Young can, when the Young receive the request from the workload, Young can handle the request and also to call the computer node, and also to to dynamically install the new features, the new IP into the FPGA card, and then the FPGA can serve for the workload it request. So for all the new feature, it is actually dynamically to allocate the new feature to the FPGA, and then when the workload get down, it will release the FPGA resources to from the resources from the Young, and also to serve for a new request for different workload or with different function. Okay. So this is a detailed implementation. It's a step-by-step implementation, just like I said. The first one is actually we use a file. We call it a node resource.xml to maintain what kind of the FPGA device that you have in a single node. So for every single node, they need to register FPGA device by using this kind of file, and node status updater will update its status to the resource manager, and after that, resource manager know how many FPGA devices and also the status with every single node. So when an application master start to submit their request. We also did some change in this type, in this standard. We added some hint to help the customer to submit their request by using FPGA device. So I will show you about the detail hint later. Okay. So after that, when the application master submit their request and to ask their FPGA resources, they will start to run the container. And when the container start to run, if you are a CPU-based workload, you will not go through the step 5. You just start your container by different node manager. But so we add a new step right here to have a local table to run the resource scheduler and also to maintain how much FPGA devices that you would like to run, and also what kind of the feature in the FPGA. We also need to register this kind of information, since FPGA is reconfigurable. So after that, the container manager can understand if this kind of node have enough resources or they need to change the IP in the local node manager. So after that, it will start to run the container if they have enough resources to run the by your workload request. All right. So we also, another thing we also have done is actually to connect to the third-party vendor tool kit. So if you would like to replace your FPGA device, of course it must be Intel-based FPGA solution. So right now we can only support for FPGA Intel-based third-party vendor to support just use their own vendor tool, and also to connect to our FPGA manager to handle this kind of request. Okay. And so this is the hint we need to do when submit your application by using the hint to allocate how many FPGA resources that you would like to run. So you can actually design the type, FPGA type, and also the FPGA IP you would like to run, and then the FPGA IP will be dynamically to install into the FPGA card. So you can use this kind of way to do that. And the other flag is actually to share your FPGA device. It depends on your features or your IP. Not only IP can provide this kind of feature, it depends on the IP design. So this way, actually, we didn't talk about how it works in your Spark. So we just talk about how to allocate the FPGA resources into your Spark by your Spark request. So it's a different topic that we can brainstorm, or depends on what kind of the features that you would like to run by your IP. So we added this kind of flag for the end customer, then they can control if they would like to share by their IP design. Okay. So this is the list about about the young patch. So you can just track the number and to get the detailed information about every single part. And the main number is actually the first one. So you can use the first one to find the other sub patch. And the last one is the lesser thing that we need to do. It is actually related with the web UI, so we haven't finished it since the web UI haven't support this kind of a feature. But the entire features from command line can be workable today. Okay. So this is the advantage I listed to you to show about, just like I said, we provide the FPGA features into Young, and also we only support for Spark on Young, but it since this feature is implemented in Young, so it maybe can also compatible with the other framework. The request is actually to support Young, but we haven't run the test, so it still depends on what kind of the framework you would like to support. And let me check. So this is the next chapter about further discussion. It's really important to let you know about right now what we have for FPGA with big data. Okay, so I listed the current IP that we have for the FPGA accelerator. So when you think about a big data workload, actually we have a data source parsing or a data compression codec IP for the Spark. So from today's presentation, we actually introduced these two IP to the audience. And you should know these two IP are just running like in this kind of way. In a task, it will run when you would like to have, for example, like a data compression. Then it will call FPGA to run this kind of support. And for the other task, the other process in the task, it will still use CPU to run the rest of things. But this kind of scenario should be very not efficiency, since there will have so many data traffic from CPU to FPGA. So what we are thinking about is actually in the future, we need to provide this kind of scenario just like to run the entire task from the FPGA. But it's really difficult to for the big data to do this kind of things, since there are so many different features you need to implement. So so we run this kind of way to handle this kind of request and also to optimize it, just like in data compression. We use both CPU and FPGA to handle the request from the CPU, and then if the FPGA is available, we will assign the task to the FPGA at first. And then if the FPGA is not available, then the task will be assigned to the CPU again. And also, to solve the queue issue in when we are using FPGA. Okay, right now we are still in this stage to have some optimization with CPU and FPGA. But in the future, I believe once every single IP has been done, then we can move to this kind of way. Another one thing that we can think about is actually just like Microsoft, they announced a new paper or a new project. They call it the Brian Wave. Brian Wave is actually to use a different way to use FPGA to for every single FPGA just need to do different data pipeline. And to string the data from the first FPGA to another one, and then to string the data from a different pipeline with multiple FPGA support. So this is another way that we can think about if we don't want just to run the FPGA like this. Since you know, this way is actually just like a CPU, since it's a common, you know, common resource. So we would like to run the CPU with the same way and with the same task. But in FPGA, we may need to narrow down the task and also to then every single task is unique and also to focusing on the FPGA. So you can have different FPGA feature or function and then to strain the data, then the you know, performance become better. Okay. So there are still some limitation that I listed here when we talk about FPGA with Spark. The first one is actually, you know, in Spark, we usually focusing on, you know, batch data processing. So it will have some barrier for every single stage. So it's not a very familiar, very friendly for the FPGA, since, you know, in FPGA we would like to show lower latency. But for Spark architecture, it usually have a barrier from different stage. So you need to wait for the first stage, on the task in the stage one, you need to finish on the task. Then you go to the next stage. It's not a very, you know, friendly for the FPGA. So we are also working on some, you know, new implementation in new architecture like Ray. Ray is a new framework for machine learning platform. They will they will no barrier from the different stage. So you don't need to wait for, you know, for the stage finish and then go to the next stage. This kind of framework should be better to implement, you know, FPGA in this kind of framework. Okay. And the second part is second problem is actually you know, in Spark they usually split the data into a small task, but for the FPGA device, it usually you know, just control a single device, and maybe right now it cannot be support multi-process. So in the future, you know, from the FPGA vendor, they usually design a single kernel to run FPGA function. That is because they don't have the concept, since, you know, they just get a lot of input data size, and then to handle, then it can be, you know, every single data will be separated by FPGA itself. But when we consider about to put FPGA into Spark, it is totally different, since, you know, in Spark we usually divided the data by task. So every single data will have will just process a small data size. It may be not a very you know, efficiency for the FPGA if you just handle a single, we call it a payload, okay? So the payload size is really small for the FPGA, but the FPGA design must be changed the concept to design the FPGA features, okay? And the third part is about, you know, different device to allocate. So, I got, you know, in the community, they have the new proposal about how to handle this kind of request. Just like we need to consider about a single task. If we run a single task and the single task must have a single core and a single GPU and a single FPGA or more, then we can allocate this kind of resource for this kind of, you know, single task. So it depends on how to handle this kind of request, and also how FPGA or GPU can provide the features for the single task. So into the, when we consider, you know, the this kind of scenario to integrate FPGA or GPU into the Spark, since it's also related with the Spark architecture. Okay. So the last one issue is actually for every single FPGA card, it has you know, different function unit for a single card. So you cannot just treat you know, the car as the same function unit. So right now, this is just our first version. So we treat every single FPGA car as you know, the same skill. So we haven't considered about the different skill. But when you consider the different skill, it may provide a very you know, different capability for a single car. If you purchase a very expensive car, then it will have a lot of function unit that you can use in a single FPGA car. So this is also what we are trying to fix, this kind of, you know, a fine-grade types or FPGA model to support more, you know, fine-grade configuration or when they are running the scheduling, okay. So this is the link that I mentioned about how to mix the CPU, GPU, and FPGA. It is still in a very early stage. You know, the community are still open discussion about how to handle this kind of scenario. So there are still no solution right now. But it's an open discussion right now to, you know, to see if there's a very good way to do that, okay. And let me check. So that's all. So for today's presentation, I just introduced about you know, we did a patch for FPGA as a first class citizen in Young, and you can just try it, you know, by using the link. And also, I introduced some opportunity and also the optimization from FPGA to Spark, and also some big data workload. Okay, so this is the last one about my contact information and also the link. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Weiting. We have 2 minutes for questions, if anyone has anything.
All right. Thank you for your talk. So I have a question about the overhead of including FPGAs in the Spark world, let's say. So is it similar to the GPU where you need to somehow transfer the data from the main memory to the FPGA memory and then do the processing there? Is this why the streaming mode is more friendly? And furthermore, can this be somehow minimized by including FPGAs as CPU co-processing units and not as external components?
Oh, yeah. So right now, you know, just like I show you here, actually right now, solution for FPGA can just handle like I just did. You know, it's a small function in Spark. So the question is about, you know, when we would like to run, you know, to read the data from, for example, okay, to read the data from the partition, it should be in H database. So we copy the data from the H database to Spark memory. And in this part, we will call this kind of function to compress or decompress your data, right? So this way, you will read the data from the partition and also to decompress from FPGA. But it will, you know, in FPGA, it will use DMA. We call it a DMA. It is a memory copy to direct copy the memory into the FPGA card. So we need to avoid this kind of, you know, traffic and also the I.O. from this kind of scenario, since if you only got one feature just to compress the data, and then you call the FPGA. After that, you didn't do anything, then it will be, you know, waste the time. If you have another feature in the later, and you need to copy the data from the FPGA again. Okay, so a better way to do that, we are considered to, you know, merge so many different IP, and also to handle the data, just focusing on, you know, pre-processing the data or post-processing the data to, you know, to have a sequential data pipeline and handle it together with FPGA. It should be the right way to do. Okay.
Great. Well, we're actually out of time. So if you have any more questions, feel free to direct to Weiting directly. But thank you for attending Spark Summit today. That was all of our sessions. Thank you.